So I'm moving to the third unit of this particular course on electronic system design. And in this particular unit, I'll be talking about the op-amp circuits. Now, I hope that you have the basic understanding about the operational amplifier. So I'm not going into the details of the basic characteristics of op-amp. Rather, in this particular unit, we'll be discussing different important op-amp circuits, which have found their significant applications in several fields. Now to start with, I'm just showing you the basic op-amp, which is symbolically shown like this. Let me just get this one. As you know, for any op-amp, you have two different input terminals, the inverting one and the non-inverting one. And for an ideal op-amp, the open loop gain of the op-amp is very large, ideally infinite, and the input resistance of the op-amp is pretty large, ideally infinite, and the output resistance is very small, ideally zero. And as far as the bandwidth of op-amp is concerned, it is considered to be very large. Now, since the open loop gain of the op-amp is very large, for example, even for a practical op-amp, the open loop gain is as large as 10 to the power 5 to 10 to the power 6. So therefore, if you make any attempt to apply any signal between these two terminals, this inverting and the non-inverting terminal. So this one is known as the inverting terminal, identified with the minus sign, and this one is known as the non-inverting terminal. And this one is known to be the output terminal for the op-amp. Now, even if we apply a few millivolt signal between these two nodes, this inverting and the non-inverting, and since the open loop gain of the op-amp is ideally infinite and practically in the order of 10 to the power 5 to 10 to the power 6, even large, so you may expect that the output of the op-amp will get saturated, because normally the 741 chip is having a supply of say 12 volt. So even if you apply like 10 millivolt signal between these two terminals, so this 10 millivolt, when it gets multiplied with some 10 to the minus, 10 to the 5, 10 to the 6, then obviously the resultant value is much higher than 12 volt. So as a matter of fact, the output voltage gets saturated at plus 12 volt or minus 12 volt, depending upon the polarity of the signal being applied. So therefore, you'll find that in most of the op-amp circuits that we will deal incorporates the feedback. And because of the feedback element present in the circuit, you'll find that the closed loop gain of the op-amp circuit is primarily controlled by the feedback element. So very briefly, I would like to mention the feedback thing, that is for any electronic amplifier, if the open loop gain is given by A and if the feedback factor is given by beta, then the gain with feedback, that means the closed loop gain, is given by A upon 1 plus A beta. So this is quite obvious. If you incorporate some negative kind of feedback, then it will be A by 1 plus A beta. And if you incorporate some positive type of feedback, then it will be A upon 1 minus A beta. Now that expression can also be written like 1 upon 1 by A plus beta. If you just divide the numerator and the denominator by A. Now, under the condition when A, that is the open loop gain of the amplifier, is pretty large, then this 1 by A can be approximated to 0, because A is very large, so 1 by A can be approximated to 0 with respect to beta, and beta is known to be the feedback factor, and then the closed loop gain or gain with feedback can be approximated to be 1 upon beta. And normally, this beta incorporates some feedback elements which are present in the circuit. So ultimately, the gain with feedback is essentially governed by the feedback elements. So that is the concept we have borrowed from the feedback amplifiers. So therefore, in the op-amp circuits, which we'll be discussing in this particular unit, we will incorporate feedback. Now, let me start with the very fundamental one. Let us try to use this operational amplifier to act as an summer, a weighted summer. So how you can do that? So let us assume that we have, say, for example, we have three different inputs like V1, V2, and V3. And by means of this operational amplifier, we would like to find out the average or the weighted average of the three input signals like V1, V2, and V3. So these inputs are being applied at the inverting terminal. So although I'm saying that there are three inputs, so it can be more than three as well. Suppose this is the first unit with some resistance. Suppose the resistance is R1 and the input we are talking about. Let this be represented by V1. Let us consider the second input. Second input is V2 and the associated resistance is R2. And let us assume that we do have another input, the third input. Similarly, you can also increase the number of inputs, but it will not affect the overall performance of the circuit. So the third input, and this is identified by V3 with the corresponding resistance R3. And this non-inverting terminal is kept at a ground potential. Now we have to, made a mistake over here. This is not directly connected over here. Rather, what you can do is, I have to incorporate the feedback part. You can connect it. At the same time, you have to show the feedback resistance so that the circuit becomes complete now. Suppose this feedback resistance is given by RF. And this is the final output voltage, if I call it to be, say, V0. So although I have seen like three inputs, V1, V2, and V3, so there could have been more than three inputs. Now, as you know, because of the notion of virtual ground, this potential at this inverting terminal is kept at the ground potential. And if you simply apply the Kirchhoff's current law, KCL, at this particular node, then you can equate the different currents which are flowing through the different branches. If I consider that this current is given by, say, I1, this current is given by, say, I2, and say this current is given by, say, I3. And suppose this current is given by IF. Then if you apply KCL at this particular node, then the total current that is entering the terminal is I1 plus I2 plus I3. And the total current that is leaving the terminal is IF. Since the op-amp is providing infinite impedance between these two terminals, so therefore there is no provision that the current will flow through this path. So whatever be the current entering this particular node, it will leave through this terminal. So I1 plus I2 plus I3. Can be written like IF. Then what about I1? So I1 is nothing but the current which is flowing through the resistance R1. That means the difference between these two terminal upon the resistance R1. So what is the difference? V1 minus 0. So V1 minus 0 by R1. So V1 by R1 plus V2 by R2. Plus V3 by R3. That is equal to IF. What about IF? So in order to calculate IF, you have to find out the voltage drop of difference between these two nodes. So at this particular point, you have a potential of 0 volt. At this particular point, you have potential of V naught, that is output voltage. So the current is 0 minus V naught upon RF. So minus VO by RF. So from that, you can write VO, that is output voltage given by minus you can write like, you can take RF outside. Or what you can do is, you can also incorporate RF inside the bracket like RF by R1 times V1 plus RF by R2 times V2 plus RF by R3 times V3. So what you find is the output voltage V0 can be written as the weighted addition of the different inputs. So these RF upon R1, RF upon R2, RF upon R3, these are the different weights which are being applied over here. And depending upon the particular value of this ratio, RF upon R1, RF upon R2, and RF upon R3, you can have V0 as a weighted sum of the different inputs. Now, the most interesting part of this particular circuit is that if you just want to add some more input in this particular branch, suppose in this particular circuit, I have shown only three inputs like V1, V2, and V3. Now, if you add more inputs like V4, V5, and so on, then it will not affect the overall performance of the circuit. Then the current flowing through the feedback resistance RF can be written like the summation of the individual currents. And since the potential at this particular point is kept fixed at the ground potential because of the virtual ground concept, therefore you can expect that the overall performance of the circuit does not get affected by the number of inputs. So you can increase the number of inputs as per your wish, and ultimately you can find the output voltage as the weighted sum of the inputs. Similarly, you can also withdraw, suppose I have shown here with three inputs, you can also withdraw some of the inputs, and then the contribution resulting from input will be absent from the expression of the output voltage, and you can have the remaining input voltage present in the final expression of the output. Now, this type of circuit is known as the summing amplifier, or it can also find out the average operation or average value of the input signal. And a popular application of this summing amplifier you'll find in case of audio mixing. Now, if all the resistances like R1, R2, R3, and RF, if all of them are same, so this is a special case. If you expect that, okay, R1 is equal to R2 is equal to R3, I mean, all the different resistances are same, and that is also equal to RF, then you can simply find that V0 is equal to minus V1 plus V2 plus V3 like this. So there is a phase reversal. So in this particular case, you will find that the output is a simple summation of the different inputs, like V1 plus V2 plus V3. But apart from that, you can also perform the weighted summation. So that is a special case. And since the inputs are being applied at the negative terminal, that means at the inverting terminal, so there is a phase difference between the output and the input, and that difference is 180 degree. So this is the very fundamental circuit to start with. This is known as the summing amplifier. So let me just write down the name over here, summing amplifier. But one thing that you must note here, that between V1, V2, and V3, there is no phase reversal. So if the inputs are applied like this, V1, V2, and V3, so within the bracket, you have all the coefficients to be positive. This RF upon R1, RF upon R2, RF upon R3, so all these resistances, these ratios like Rf upon Ri, if I call. So these resistances are, these ratios are positive. So therefore, you can only have weighted summation. And in between the inputs, like V1 and V2, there is no phase reversal. So they are always added in the same phase. Now, sometimes it is also required to find out the difference between the two inputs, or weighted difference to some extent. Now, for this particular purpose, this particular circuit will not be operative. Rather, you have to apply the inputs, the two inputs at two different terminals, one input at the inverting terminal and the one input at the non-inverting terminal, to the proper resistive feedback network. And this network is known as, or this amplifier is known as, the difference amplifier. So let me just show you the complete circuitry. So you have two different inputs, like the inverting input and the non-inverting input terminal. And you are going to apply the inputs accordingly. So one input is being applied at the non-inverting terminal. Through a resistive network. And the other input has to be applied at the inverting terminal through another resistive network. We can do this, I can just change the position. Or rather, it will be better if I just first draw the resistive network first. Now here you apply the input at the inverting terminal. Now let me call this to be the input V1, this to be the input V2. This to be resistance R1, this is resistance R2, this one is R3, this one is R4, and you are collecting the output from this particular node, V0. Now, this particular circuit accepts two input, that is V1 and V2, and we are going to find out what is the relation between V0, V1 and V2. Now, out of the two inputs, V1 is applied at the inverting terminal through some resistive network, and V2 is applied at the non-inverting terminal to another resistive network. Now, to find out the overall output, you have to apply, to find out this V0, you have to apply the theory of superposition. So if I assume that because of the application of V1, so whenever you're going to apply V1, the corresponding output is, suppose, let me call the output to VO1 because of V1. And because of V2, if the corresponding output is, say, VO2, then whenever you are applying V1 and V2 together, then by virtue of the superposition principle, you can say that the overall output VO will be the summation of these two, VO1 plus VO2. So first of all, you have to calculate the individual outputs like VO1 and VO2. Then what about VO1? So whenever you're going to apply V1 over here at the inverting end, then you have to make this particular voltage source inactive. So that means this should be connected to ground directly. So V2 is inactive whenever you're going to apply V1 only. Now, if this potential equal to zero, that means the potential at this point and this non-inverting node is also zero. And because of the virtual ground concept, this potential is also equal to zero over here. So now the circuit looks pretty simple, and you have the operational amplifier operating in the inverting mode. and you know the relation, I mean the output input relation. The relation is output voltage VO1 when the op amp is acting in the inverting mode can be written like minus R2 by R1 into the input. So that is fine, the expression for VO1. So this is the value of the output when V1 is acting only and V2 is inactive. Then what about V2? Whenever we apply V2 over here, then you have to make V1 inactive. That means this potential must be, I mean, this point should be connected to the ground terminal. And under these circumstances, this particular op amp will be acting in the non-inverting mode with the input equal to V2. So if I consider that, okay, if that potential, if I call that potential equal to Vp, for example, then if you apply V2 over here, then you can easily find out what is the expression for Vp. So Vp is given by R4 upon R3 plus R4 into V2, simple voltage divider law. That means you are applying Vp over here at the non-inverting terminal. And you have R1 here, R2 here, and this potential, this terminal is connected to ground. So therefore, the circuit operates in the non-inverting mode. Then whatever the output voltage, then the output voltage is given by 1 plus R2 by R1 multiplied with the input. So that input is Vp. So we can write VO2, that means the output of the amplifier when V2 is acting alone. So here the gain is given by 1 plus R2 upon R1. It's a positive gain. Multiplied with the input. So here the input is Vp. So you can write like 1 plus R2 upon R1 into R4 by R3 plus R4 into V2. So now we have already obtained two different output components, VO1 and VO2. Then the overall expression for the output can be written like VO, when both of them are acting together, VO1 plus VO2. So that is given by minus R2 upon R1 into V1 plus this one. That means 1 plus R2 upon R1 into R4 by R3 plus R4 into V2. So what you can do is you can take like R2 upon R1 common. Now if you take R2 upon R1 common, then from this part you have like if you take R2 upon R1 common, then you have 1 plus R1 by R2 and this one R4 into R4 divided by R3 plus R4 multiplied with V2 minus simply V1. Let me go to the next slide and write down the final expression for the output voltage. So the output voltage expression was like R2 upon R1, and then you have 1 plus R1 plus R2. So let me just once again copy this entire thing. R3 plus R4 V2 minus V1. that can be simplified, like you can further simplify this one to be like R2 by R1, that can be written in the numerator 1 plus R1 by R2. And then and that can be written like 1 plus, if you divide by R4, then it will be 1 plus R3 upon R4. Into V2 minus V1. So now what you find is, this output voltage can be written as, once again, it's a weighted summation, because if you consider the subtraction as a kind of summation, kind of addition, so weighted addition of two inputs V2 and V1. But the only difference between this model and the last one was that this time the two coefficients are having opposite polarity. Last time, if you just remember, the two coefficients like RF upon R1, RF upon R2, RF upon R3, so all of them are having the same polarity. This time, this is having a positive component, 1 plus R1 by R2 divided by 1 plus R3 by R4. However, for V1, the corresponding weight is minus 1. So this is the difference. And you can make it even more simplified if you consider that these two ratios are same. That means if I consider that this particular bridge is in a balanced condition, that means the ratio of these two resistances, R1, R2, and R3 and R4, being the same, then under this condition, you will find that now with R1 by R2 is equal to R3 by R4 with this condition. If that condition holds good, then it implies that the output voltage can be written as R2 by R1, this is the gain, multiplied with V2 minus V1. That means a pure difference. So you have two different inputs, V1 and V2. V2 is applied at the non-inverting terminal and V1 is applied at the inverting terminal. So their difference is simply V2 minus V1, and that difference gets multiplied with some constant, that is R2 by R1, and that is the final output voltage. Now this condition holds good only when the two resistance pairs is R1, R2 and R3, R4, they are in a balanced condition, balanced bridge condition. And under these circumstances only, you will find that this output voltage can be written as the proportional to the true difference of the inputs. So you have these two different inputs, V1 and V2, and their true difference is V2 minus V1. So this is only possible if this condition holds good. And however, so as you can understand that the purpose of this amplifier circuit is to find out the difference between the two inputs being applied at the positive and the negative terminal of its two input side. So accordingly, this one is known as the difference amplifier. And you'll find that this difference amplifier is having its serious applications as the building block of instrumentation amplifier, which we'll be discussing in some other lectures. So it is known as difference amplifier. So after the addition and the subtraction operation, now let us move to some other circuit operation. And I believe that that particular circuit we have already discussed in our first unit, that is in unit number 1, whenever we have talked about the RC low pass filter and the RC high pass filter. That means so far we have seen that the circuit involves only the resistance as the feedback elements. We have only resistance, R1, R2, R3, RF, so all of them are resistances. Now, instead of using resistance, now if I have a capacitor in the circuit as well, then how does the circuit perform? So that is another important issue to discuss in this particular unit. So let us now consider that we have this op amp. Suppose the input is being applied and the inverting node with a capacitor in series, and in the feedback path you have a resistance. And this non-inverting terminal is grounded. That is the output node, VO. So this one is VI. Let me call this to be C, this to be R. Let us now mark the current. If I call the current through this is IC and through this is IR. So one thing is very clear that these two current must be the same, because this op amp is providing infinite impedance. Between these two nodes, we have infinite impedance. So therefore, this IC and IR must be the same. So how can I write IR? So IR can be written as, so what is the voltage difference between these two terminals? So at this particular point, you have a potential of zero, because this non-inverting terminal is connected to the ground potential. So this potential should be zero, and this potential is V naught. So it is minus V naught upon R. And what about this current? So this current, as you know, this current through the capacitor can be written as, IC is equal to C dV/dt. So what is the voltage difference between the two plates of the capacitor? So at the left hand plane, you have a voltage of VI, and the right hand plane, you have a voltage of zero. So the difference is VI minus zero, that is VI. So IC is given by C dV/dt. Now, since IC and IR, these two are same, so you can equate quite easily. So you can write like V naught upon R is equal to minus C dV/dt, or V naught is equal to minus RC dV/dt. That means you find that this output voltage is given as the derivative of the input signal, the time derivative of the input signal. So if the input signal varies with respect to time, then the time derivative of the input signal multiplied with some constant, this RC constant, you'll be getting the output voltage. Now, since this particular circuit performs operation of differentiation, so that's why this circuit is known as the differentiator involving op amp. Already you have seen that simple capacitor CR combination. In the first unit, in unit one, you have seen that CR combination, RC combination can also serve the purpose of a differentiator. But that particular circuit involves only the passive elements like resistance, capacitors, and so on. But in this particular circuit, it involves an active element like an op amp. And that's why this particular operation or this particular differentiation is even more accurate and even more precise. So let me just complete the discussion about this circuit. This is known as a differentiator. Similarly, if I just change the swap the position of the capacitor and resistance in this particular circuit arrangement, then you can readily understand that this will be something opposite what you're thinking about. Let me just explain, or let me just establish this one mathematically. So let us just change the location of the input and the output, I mean the capacitor and the resistance. Suppose here you have a resistance, and then you have a capacitor over here. So suppose this is VI, this is VO, This one is the capacitor C, this one is the resistance R. So similarly, you can find out the current that is flowing through this path. So that current is given by, so if I call that, okay, this current is given by IR, and say this current is given by IC, then following the same analogy, we can write that IR is given by VI upon R, and IC is given by minus C dV0 dt, because here the potential difference between the two plates of the capacitor is minus V0, and we are assuming that the current is flowing in this direction. So therefore, accordingly, the voltage difference is minus V0, 0 minus V0. So the current is given by minus C dV0 dt. Now, since both of them are same, so we have to equate like VI upon R is equal to minus C dV0 dt. So from that, you can write like dV0 is equal to minus 1 upon RC VI dt. So from that, you can write V0 as a function of time can be written as 1 upon RC integration over 0 to t some, say, VI alpha d alpha plus the initial voltage, initial output voltage. That initial output voltage depends upon the initial charge stored inside the capacitor. So we have incorporated one dummy variable over here, that is alpha. So V naught t is given by the integration of the input signal. Now, since this particular circuit performs the operation of an integrator, so it is well known as the integrator circuit, and since it involves the operational amplifier in particular, an active element, so it is known as a precision integrator because of its high level of accuracy. So this is integrator. So these are the some fundamental mathematical operations which you can perform, like addition, subtraction, differentiation, integration by means of op-amp. So that's why these op-amps are known as, or these particular amplifiers are known as operational amplifiers. So you can it can perform different types of operations by connecting the different elements in the feedback network. Before I say anything regarding this, let me just show you another important consideration or another important operation that can be performed by this op-amp circuit. Let us now consider that we would like to find out the value of resistance. Suppose we do have a resistance like this. Suppose the value is R. And suppose we would like to find out the value of the resistance by some means. Now, you know how to find out the resistance value because this is very fundamental. From your basic understanding in physics, you know that how to find out the value of a resistance. I'm not considering the color code kind of decoding. If you have a resistance, you can very easily find out the resistance value. The only thing that you need to do is that across the two terminals of the resistance, you have to connect or you have to develop a voltage difference between these two terminals. And suppose this is V reference, and you have to find out what is the current that is flowing through the resistance, and you can easily find out the value of the resistance like V reference upon I reference. So that is quite obvious. But you cannot somehow change the value of the resistance. You can just find out what is the value of the resistance by that particular means. But you cannot transform the value of the resistance. The value of the resistance will be kept constant. Now that transformation is also possible if you connect this resistance in a feedback loop of an op-amp circuit. How is it possible? Let me just show you. In fact, what we have done is show you the same thing from a different angle. You have a resistance over here, and you have measured the value of the resistance in this particular fashion. Suppose this is the R resistance, and this is the V reference. And you have just measured the current which is flowing through the resistance. That is I difference, for example. Now, instead of putting this lower terminal of the resistance to the ground, in order to transform the resistance, or in order to transform that particular impedance, this is connected, this terminal of the resistance is connected to the output terminal of an op-amp. And this point is connected to the non-inverting input of the op-amp. And the inverting input of the op-amp is having a different resistive feedback network. That means, what I mean to say is, you have op-amp like this. Now you have a voltage source. That terminal, fine. And here, this resistance that we're talking about is connected in a feedback path like this between the output and the non-inverting terminal. And the inverting terminal, you have a different resistive network like this. Let me just change it. So just like this. So let me call this to be say R1, this to be say R2. This was the resistance we are talking about, R. This to be V0, this to be VI. Then what is the added advantage if I connect instead of connecting a voltage source between the two terminals of the resistance in order to find out the value of the resistance? If I make this kind of arrangement, then what is the additional advantage we are getting out of that? Now, first of all, you have to appreciate that this is a kind of network which is applicable for the non-inverting amplifier, because the input is applied at the non-inverting terminal, the positive terminal. So you can easily find out what is the value of this output voltage. So this output voltage can be written as, you know, for a non-inverting amplifier, what about the gain of the circuit? The gain of the circuit is essentially governed by the resistive network, this R1 and R2. And this one is basically given by 1 plus R2 upon R1 into the input voltage, that is VI. Then what about the perception of this signal source? Last time, during this type of arrangement, this V reference was connected between the one end of the resistance and ground. And the corresponding current being drawn by the resistance was I reference, and therefore, this signal source this reference voltage can easily identify what about the impression of the resistance. Here the objective was to find out the value of the resistance. So that calculation was done on the basis of supplying a particular value of the voltage and finding out the current being drawn by the load. And the ratio of these two, the supplied voltage and the, so if I just consider, okay, there is a borderline over here. I don't know what is there outside. I don't know what is there outside. So that part is completely unknown to me. That part is completely unknown. I know that something is there. So what is the load? You know, to find out the load, I have connected one end to the reference voltage source and the other end is grounded. So the voltage being provided is V reference, and you have to find out what is the being, what is the current being flown. Suppose the current being flown is I reference, then the ratio of these two, V reference by I reference, will give you the value of the resistance. But it cannot modulate the value of the resistance. It cannot change. It cannot transform the value of the resistance. If you do this simple connection like this. On the other hand, if you do like this, if you have included one active device like an op amp and some other resistances in the path, there also you have to identify what about the current. So suppose in this particular case, so let us assume there is a boundary line, but the connection is completely different. Here, this terminal of the resistance is not connected to ground, unlike previously. This time it is connected to the output of an op amp, and the inverting mode of the op amp is also having some resistive feedback connection like this. But this signal source is completely unaware of this. Now, what it feels is the input voltage is Vi, and suppose the current, let me call the current to be say I, which is being drawn in this path. Then to this signal source, the effective resistance being felt by the signal source is given by Vi upon I. But this I is not equal to simply Vi upon R. Rather, it is something different. Then how to measure this? Now, as you know, this current will flow through this path. So therefore, you have to find out the voltage difference. So at this particular point, you have voltage equal to Vi. And at this particular node, you have voltage equal to 1 plus R2 by R1 into Vi. And what about the current? So the current I is the voltage difference, that means Vi minus 1 plus R2 upon R1 into Vi. That is the voltage difference between these two nodes divided by the resistance, that is R. So that is equal to, so Vi gets cancelled. So then you have minus R2 by R1 into R into Vi. And what about the effective resistance being seen by this particular signal source? So the effective resistance being seen by the signal source Vi upon I so the effective resistance Vi upon I is given by minus R1 by R2 into R. So instead of having simple R, so now the effective resistance is given by minus R1 by R2 into R. So apart from this multiplication by a different factor like R1 by R2, another interesting observation is that you have a negative sign over here. That means it gives you the notion of a negative resistance. Then what is the implication of having a negative resistance? So in one word, we can say that this particular circuit simulates a negative resistance. Now, what is the implication of the negative resistance? You have to identify this one. The implication of the negative resistance is that, although we have shown that the current is flowing in this direction from this point to this point, from this terminal to this terminal. In fact, since the value of the resistance is negative, that means in reality, the current will flow from this terminal to that terminal. And that is quite obvious because for this particular resistance, if I have a connection like this, so this left-hand node is having a potential of Vi and the right-hand node is having a potential which is greater than Vi. So therefore, it is quite obvious that the current will flow from this point to this point, from right-hand side to the left-hand side. So unlike to our convention. So conventionally, I've assumed that, okay, the current will be flowing from this end to this end. But in fact, the current will be flowing in the opposite direction. So that means we can say that the current will be flowing from this terminal to this terminal. And as a matter of fact, this negative resistance will release power. Last time, what happens was this V reference, this reference voltage was releasing some current. And as a matter of fact, this current was absorbed by the resistance, this resistance R. And accordingly, the heat was generated over here. So last time, this reference voltage source, this particular source, releases power and the resistance R absorbs the power if I do not do any kind of modification in the circuit. But this time, this resistance releases the power because the current for the direction of the current is just the opposite. So this resistance releases the power and the power is getting absorbed over here by the signal source. Now you will find the advantage or you will find the application of this this resistance converter. This is known as a negative resistance converter because you have provided some positive resistance like R, and by means of this circuit some negative resistance has been generated and it is also converted because there is some magnification. So if I consider that, okay, these two resistances are same, that means if R1 and R2, if both of them are same, then only you have a negative sign over here, no other difference. But if you select two different values for these two resistances, R1 and R2, then apart from the negative sign, the value of the resistance is also getting different. So I'm just writing the name of the circuit first, and then I'll be talking about what is the implication of this. So this is negative resistance converter. Now, what is the implication of having this negative resistance? Now, the application is that sometimes in any particular circuit, you may be required to neutralize some unwanted ordinary resistance. Suppose you know that there are certain resistances that you want to neutralize, that you don't want to take into account into your circuit, but somehow that resistance has come over there. So then what you can do is, you can make an arrangement like this. So for example, let me just show you very briefly over here. Suppose in any particular circuit, suppose you know that, okay, between these two terminal, you have some resistance which you do not want to have between these two nodes. Suppose this is node A and this is node B. You want that this node A and node B should be perfectly short circuited. There should not be any resistance between these two nodes. But however, you'll find that some resistance is present. More specifically for the design of current source, you'll find that the application of this kind of negative resistance. So therefore, you are also unaware about the value of the resistance. You might be knowing the range of the resistance, might be in the tens of ohms range or kilo ohms range or even higher, but you do not know the exact value of the resistance. But suppose you want to neutralize the resistance, you don't want to have this resistance be imparted in your circuit. So then this concept will be very useful. And if you make one of these two resistances, either R1 or R2, as a variable one, then you can also modulate the value of the negative resistance, because as long as R1, R2, and R, both of them, all of them are having a constant value, then from this particular arrangement, you can only synthesize some negative resistance, some fixed value negative resistance, but that cannot be variable, that cannot be made variable. So in order to make this one variable, what you can do is one of the resistances can be made variable by means of potentiometer. And then since the minus n is there already, so because of the presence of this negative resistance, you'll find that these unwanted ordinary resistances, the effect of this unwanted ordinary resistance can be eliminated from the circuit. So that is one of the biggest advantages of having this negative resistance converter. So now what you can find is that this operational amplifier can do lots of operations, lots of mathematical operations, like addition operation, subtraction operation, differentiation operation, integration operation, and as well as resistance conversion operation. And that's why this particular circuit topology or this particular family of amplifiers are known as the operational amplifier, because it can do lots of operations, lots of mathematical operations. Now, I would like to move to some other aspect of this operational amplifier. So as you know that these operational amplifiers can be used to develop some magnified signal through non-inverting mode or through inverting mode. But apart from that, some additional implication can be obtained by using the amplifier as a trans-resistance amplifier, and sometimes by using the amplifier as a trans-conductance amplifier. So whenever we say that, okay, the input is Vo, input is applied, we are applying some voltage input and we are getting some voltage output. So obviously, this if we just calculate the gain of the circuit, so it will be unitless, because the output is also voltage, input is also voltage. But sometimes the circuit, this op-amp circuit, can be utilized to provide some output voltage when the input is a current, and the reverse one. It can generate some output current when the input is a voltage. So accordingly, you can have two different converters, and which I would like to discuss very briefly. So the first one that I would like to mention here is a kind of converter which will convert the current to voltage. So here the input should be current, and the output that we are taking should be in the form of voltage. So let us assume that this current input is being applied. So we have a current source over here now. So now you have a current source. To reduce it to some extent. It's gone. The same thing. Anyway, what I mean to say is that it should be connected at the inverting node, and there is some resistance over here, and output is in the voltage. So this is II, for example. And let us assume that this one is given by R. I would like to find out what is the relation between V0 and II. So as you can understand that because of the virtual ground concept, this potential should be at the ground potential, because the non-inverting terminal is also kept at the ground potential. So therefore, if I consider the current, if the current flowing through the circuit, so that current must be equal to II, because it cannot find any path for branching, because the input impedance is infinite. ideally infinite, practically very large, so there should not be any branching through this path. So if II is input current, so this entire II current will be flowing through this. And then what about the output voltage? So output voltage developed over here, if I write like V naught, so that is given by minus R into II. So the output voltage can be written as minus R. So this minus R can be considered to be, you can consider this V naught as some gain multiplied with the input current. So input current is given by II, and the gain of the amplifier is given by AR, where AR is known to be the trans resistance gain, because here the input is the current and the output is the voltage. So it's a kind of current to voltage conversion. And here, as you find that this AR is coming in the unit of resistance. And the negative sign is because of the fact that if I just change the direction of the current, instead of showing the current in this direction, if I just change the direction of the current, then obviously you can have a positive output voltage over here. So that's not a big issue. So what you find is this output voltage is given by some constant, some resistance, multiplied with the input current. So there is a conversion between the input current to the output voltage. And that conversion is possible by virtue of the resistance. And this resistance is known as the gain, the trans resistance amplification factor of this particular amplifier. And sometimes it is also known as the sensitivity of the circuit, because it's a kind of conversion. So it can also be used as a transducer. So you have an input as a current, and you are generating a voltage at its output. So that conversion is made possible by means of this particular circuit. And more precisely, this is related with the value of the resistance. So if I consider that, okay, that particular circuit is having a sensitivity of say one volt per milliampere. Suppose this is the sensitivity. So since it's a kind of conversion, one type of input and different types of outputs. So if I call that the sensitivity of the circuit, sensitivity, if I call that, okay, this is 1 volt per 1 milliampere. What is the meaning of the term? That means if there is a 1 milliampere change in the input current, whatever be the direction of the current, we are not bothered right now. If there is 1 milliampere change in the input current, then it results in the 1 volt change in the output voltage. So that gives you the notion of sensitivity. So then you know that this 1 volt by 1 milliampere, so obviously the resistance value should be 1 kilo ohms. On the other hand, so the resistance should be, so R should be 1 kilo ohms. On the other hand, if the sensitivity is like, I'm saying that, okay, so sensitivity even larger, like for a 1 microampere change, suppose the same voltage difference, so then the resistance value should be 1 megaohm. Perhaps you can understand what is the notion being served by this particular circuit. If there is a 1 milliampere change in the input current, suppose the corresponding change in the output voltage is given by 1 volt. So then the sensitivity is given by 1 volt per milliampere, and that has to be accomplished by a 1 kilo ohm resistance. On the other hand, suppose I would like to calibrate a circuit in such a fashion that even for a smaller input variation, even if the input current varies by an amount of 1 microampere, then also I am expecting the same 1 volt excursion should be there at the output side. That means the second one is even more sensitive. The first one is less sensitive because the 1 volt fluctuation of the output voltage because of 1 milliampere change in the input current. And here, the same fluctuation of output voltage, but with a smaller fluctuation of the input current. So second one is even more sensitive. And then the sensitivity is directly reflected in the value of resistance. So it's 1 kilo ohm, it's 1 megaohm. And sometimes we expect that, okay, we want that our circuit should be highly sensitive so that even for a smaller change in the input signal, the larger change can be reflected at the output side. So from this discussion, you can understand that that is only possible just by increasing the value of the resistance. That means if I use, say, 1 mega ohm, 10 mega ohm, even larger resistance, then obviously the sensitivity of the circuit could be increased. But increasing the resistance value is not a good solution, because you cannot get the value of the resistance at per your requirement, because depending upon your sensitivity, the circuit cannot, circuit cannot be built with that value of the resistance. And moreover, this resistance value can also be variable to some extent. So unless you adopt some proper circuit fabrication measure, and then obviously you cannot expect that that high value of this sensitivity can be achieved. So sometimes we can expect that this is to some extent unrealistic. So that can be accomplished. That means the enhancement of the sensitivity without increasing or without using a very high value of the resistance can be possible by means of a modified circuit. So before going into that circuit, let me just mention what is the name of the circuit. So it's current to voltage converter. It's current to voltage converter. So somehow we have to use some feasible resistance value, and we would like to increase the sensitivity as well. So that can be accomplished by means of some modified arrangement. So let me just show you this one. So in fact, you should have a T-type of network so that this is becoming possible. So you have a current source. You have a current source. Let's change this one. Doesn't look good. Yeah. Now it's fine. So this is the current source, II. Now last time you are having a simple resistance over here between this point and the output terminal. Now this time we would like to have a T-type of connection. So that resistance is not directly connected to the output terminal, rather we would like to have a connection like this, a T-type of connection, T of three resistances. So let me call, like this one is R, the previous resistance that we have used. Say this one is given by, say, R2, this one is given by R1. And in fact, this is the output node, V0. Let me call this node to be, say, node. This is a node T. So last time, this resistance was directly connected to the output terminal of the op-amp, but this time we have made little modification of the circuit and we have come to this particular circuit. Now, if we apply the KCL at node T, so let us apply Kirchhoff's current law at node T. And let us just try to add on all the currents. So if the potential here, if I call this potential to be, say, Vt, And this potential should be at ground potential. So what is the current entering the terminal through this? So that current should be, see if I just call, okay, there are three currents. Anyway, I can do it. So it's zero and Vt. So zero minus Vt by R plus zero minus Vt by R1 plus V naught minus Vt by R2 is equal to zero. That should be equal to zero. So what you can do is we can take V naught in one side. So V naught upon R2 is equal to Vt upon R plus Vt upon R1 plus Vt upon R2. Then how this Vt is related to II? So as you know, since the total current II will be flowing through this path, the total current II will be flowing through this path because there is no branching. So this Vt can be written as minus R times II. So Vt can be written as Vt is minus R times II. So now that can be written like, okay, we can take Vt outside. So minus R times II into 1 by R plus 1 by R1 plus 1 by R2. So now if I like to write V naught in terms of II, then it should be like, so R2 should be multiplied over here. So you should have minus, I can write like minus K times R into II. That K is given by, so K is nothing but this entire thing inside the bracket multiplied with R. Because last time you have, in this particular circuit, you have V naught is equal to minus R times II. So this minus R times II is already there. So I would like to have this K as the product of R2 with this entire thing inside the bracket. So what about K? So that K is given by R2 multiplied with this entire thing. So 1 R2 by R2, that is 1, plus R2 by R1 plus R2 by R. So obviously, it is quite obvious that the value of K is, it should be greater than 1. Because 1 plus something, it should be greater than 1. And if you wish, you can make it like 100, 200, 500, depending upon the ratio of these two resistances, R1 and R2 and R2 and R. Then ultimately, there is a magnification. So you have used the same value of the resistance, R, but this time the sensitivity is given by KR. Last time the sensitivity was given by simple R, but this time the sensitivity is given by K times R, where K is, so I should mention over here. So here the sensitivity of the circuit, sensitivity is given by K times R, and which is obviously greater than R because K is greater than 1. So this circuit is known as a high sensitive current voltage converters because the sensitivity can be improved. So high sensitive current to voltage converter. So we can see that this op-amp circuit can also be useful in providing the output voltage in response to some input current. Similarly, the reverse operation can also be performed. The reverse operation means that the voltage to current converter. So this time our objective is that it is known to be a transconductance type amplifier. So last time the sensitivity was recorded in units of ohms, and for a transconductance amplifier, the sensitivity has to be recorded in units of mho, 1/ohm, because here the input should be the voltage and the output should be the current. So we can write like I naught, that is the output current. So this output current can now be written as some AG times VI. Practically speaking, this AG times VI will not be useful always, or will not be available always, because whenever we are talking about the current to voltage converter, so only one node is good enough. This output voltage node is good enough, which can have this corresponding voltage. So you can easily measure, okay, in response to this particular current, you can easily measure what is the amount of voltage. But whenever we are doing the reverse operation, that means voltage to current conversion, then this floating node will not do our purpose, because this time you have to provide some current. And in order to provide some current, or in order to provide a path to the current, a floating node will not suffice. So in that case, you have to provide a branch through which this current can flow, this output current can flow, because this time your circuit operation is just reverse. Here the circuit operation is voltage to current conversion. So the current has to be generated from the circuit in response to the voltage, and you have to provide a path for this current to flow. Otherwise, the circuit is going to malfunction. So since it outputs a current, therefore the circuit requires a load in order to work. Therefore, if you keep this output port open, then obviously there is a kind of, there is a possibility of malfunction. So therefore, there is a notion of a load voltage apart from the your this output terminal. So this load voltage is also important over here, and this load voltage and the output voltage may not also be equal. Sometimes it is different, and sometimes it can also be same. So this expression of this output output current with the input voltage can also be modified to some extent, and that modification you will find that this is like, apart from that, there could have been some load voltage, and if the resistance, output resistance seen by the load, if it is given by R naught, then this output current can be written as a summation of these two. So this plus and minus, I mean, this minus sign is not of having any significance. You can also put a plus sign over here. That is depending upon the convenience that we are putting over here. But for a more realistic term, we can say that this output current resulting from any voltage to current converter circuits, voltage to current op amp converter circuit, it is not exactly equal to like AG times into VI. Rather, sometimes you have some additional component resulting from the load voltage. And this load voltage and output voltage, they are not also same. Sometimes they can be thought to be same depending upon the circuit arrangement, and sometimes they are different as well. So whenever you talk about a load, so that load can be anything. You can have a simple resistive load, you can have some, I mean, a linear load like resistance, you can have a non-linear load like a diode, you can have a time dependent load like capacitor. So you can have different types of load, but at least you have to provide a path through which this output current can flow. Now, in regard to this the load, the type of the load, now this load can be categorized into two different classes. One is known as the floating load. Now, when you find that the both the terminals of the load are uncommitted, then it is known as a floating load. That means you do not have any idea about the two terminals of the load. So let us assume that, okay, this is the load. So I don't know what is there inside the load. It can be anything. You can have a resistance over here, you can have a diode over here, you can have a capacitor over here. I do not know what is there. So this is the load, and through which this output current will be flowing. Now, when these two terminals of the load are uncommitted, that means if I do not have any idea, if I do not have any guess regarding these two nodes, I mean these two nodes of the load, then it is known as the floating load. So it can be connected to any potential. And on the other hand, if one terminal of the load is connected to a ground potential or to a known potential, then it is known as the grounded load. So this load can be categorized into two different classes. One is the floating load. That means both the terminals of the load are uncommitted. That means we cannot say that, okay, this potential is always constant. And the second condition or second type of load we're talking about is known as a grounded load. In case of grounded load, one of the terminals of the load is connected to the ground or to some other potential, at least some fixed potential. Now, whenever we are talking about the floating load, so that means the two terminals are uncommitted, then you can use this load in the feedback path of any op-amp circuit. However, for the grounded load, this is not at all possible. So let us now try to investigate the first option, that is the floating load, with the input signal being applied at the non-inverting terminal. And let us check what happens. That means we are having an op-amp like this, and the input signal is applied at the non-inverting terminal. So here the input should be the voltage, because we are going to realize a voltage to current converter. So let it be VI. And you do have a load. Suppose this load is connected between the inverting terminal and the output terminal. Now, since the potential at these two terminals are not at all constant, so therefore you can consider this load to be a kind of floating load. And you have a resistance over here. Suppose this resistance is given by R. And you have a load. So you can have any types of load. And this is the output voltage V0. And suppose the load voltage, suppose the load current is flowing in this direction, which is also the output current resulting from the voltage to current converter. And the load voltage is having the polarity as shown like this here. So now you have to analyze the circuit, and you have to check whether this particular circuit can produce current, output current in response to some input voltage. So if I consider, okay, the output current is given by I0, that is the current being provided, being generated by the op-amp circuit, then obviously we are providing this load through which this output current will flow. And since there is no branching, so this output current will also be flowing through the resistance R over here. So potential at this point is given by simply VI because of the virtual ground concept. And so therefore, we can write that the potential, the voltage drop across this resistance R is given by R times I0. And that is equal to the input voltage VI. Or in other words, I can write I0 as 1 by R times VI. But however, as you can find, the load voltage and the output voltage, they are not the same. If you just apply the Kirchhoff's voltage law at this particular node, you will find that this output voltage here is nothing but, so here this potential is VI, this potential is VL. So output voltage VO is nothing but the summation of the input voltage plus the load voltage. However, in some other circuit arrangement, you will find that the output voltage is exactly equal to the load voltage. Sometimes it could have been different. And in regard to that, there is another important term which is known as the voltage compliance. So what do you mean by the voltage compliance? Because as you know, depending upon the available input which has been applied, the op-amp can operate in the either in the linear region or in the non-linear region. So if the op-amp enters into the saturation region, then obviously you cannot expect that this amplification operation is going to be valid. So the voltage compliance will give you the range of permissible values of the load voltage for which the circuit can operate satisfactorily or it can operate properly. That means before the onset of any saturation effect on the part of the op amp, what about the available voltage what about the available range for the load voltage? That will give you the value of the voltage compliance. And obviously you should expect that for any circuit the voltage compliance should be as high as possible, so that you can have a bigger range, you can have a wider range to work with. Now if you just consider this circuit, you first of all you have to take a look at the what about the voltage compliance of this circuit. One thing is very clear that this output voltage can output current can be written as some constant, this 1 upon R multiplied with VI, irrespective of the type of the load. So whether it's a resistive load or a diode or a capacitor, it's always 1 upon R times VI. So that means this part is not coming into the picture. The next part is not coming into the picture over here. However, you'll find that for a grounded load kind of consideration, this part will be coming into the picture. Anyway, so what you find is this particular circuit can perform this voltage to current conversion with a transconductance given by 1 upon R. So that is fine. But what about the voltage compliance? Because you know that this output voltage can be, or I mean, this output voltage is limited between, so there is a limit for the output voltage, the lower limit and the higher limit. So VO, that is output voltage, should be limited between these two values, VOL and POH. So it should be greater than VOL and it should be less than POH. That is the limit of the output voltage. For example, if this op amp is provided with a 12 volt supply, then this VOL will be minus 12 volt and VOH will be plus 12 volt. If you have a plus 12 volt, minus 12 volt supply like this. So this VO is limited by this particular value. Then what about the voltage compliance? Because VO is given by VI plus VL. So therefore, the voltage compliance, if I just consider the value of VL, so then it is VOL minus VI less than VL less than VOH minus VI. So voltage compliance of the load, I mean, if you just calculate the voltage compliance, that is the permissible value for the load voltage, is to some extent it is given by VOL minus VI to VOH minus VI. That means both the lower and the higher value has been diminished by some amount, that is VI. On the other hand, let us take a look at the other type of circuit involving obviously the floating load, where the input is applied at the inverting terminal. So this time, the non-inverting terminal is connected to the ground. So this time, this is connected to the ground. And we are going to apply the input voltage. I'm making the same mistake many a times. Anyway, it would be better to draw the resistance first. Fine. So so this is input voltage VI, and we have got a resistance over here, and the load is connected just like this. So almost the same circuit. The only difference is that we have just swapped the position of the input voltage between the inverting terminal to the non-inverting terminal. This is V0, this is load. Now since VI is applied over here, so I may consider, okay, this is the VL, load voltage, and assuming that the current will be flowing in this direction. This is the current IO. So now, if we just calculate the current, so this potential should be at the ground potential because of the virtual ground concept. And the current, this kind will be the same. So this I naught can be written as VI minus 0 by R that is equal to Vi by R. So the only difference, if you just observe this between these two, there is no such specific difference as far as the voltage to current conversion is considered. You find that output current IO can be written as 1 upon R, this is the transconductance gain of the amplifier, multiplied with the input voltage, that is Vi. That is fine. But what about the, what is the relation between the output voltage and the load voltage? Now you see that since this potential is connected, I mean, this potential is at the ground potential because of the virtual ground concept. So therefore V0 and VL. So if you just apply KVL over here, so plus minus and then plus minus. So that means V0 plus VL, if you apply the KVL around this loop, then it should be equal to zero. That means V0 is equal to minus VL. So this time V0 is equal to minus VL. And you know that this output voltage is limited between VOL and VOH, between these two values. Similarly, since V0, if you just consider the magnitude of this output voltage and the load voltage, so they're being the same. So therefore, this load voltage is also limited by the same. That means the voltage compliance is the same. So here the load voltage varies in between the lower level of the output voltage and the higher level of the output voltage, unlike the previous case. The last time you have seen that this voltage compliance is something different. Both the lower level and as well as the higher level has been diminished by some amount, by the amount of the input voltage. So that is the difference that you can expect over here. However, both of these two arrangements that you have considered so far incorporates the floating load. That means the load is used as a feedback element, because if the load is used as a feedback element, then none of the terminals of the load is committed. Both the terminals are uncommitted, and therefore you can use it as a feedback element. However, if you want to use the load as a grounded load, in which case the one end, one terminal of the load is connected to ground potential, then obviously you cannot connect it as a feedback element. So let us look at such a circuit. So let me just start with the op amp first. Suppose we are applying the input at the non-inverting terminal. That is fine. And suppose there is a resistance, okay, between the output terminal and the non-inverting terminal, and suppose the load is connected between this point and the ground terminal. So now this load can be considered to be a grounded load, because one end of the load is fixed. So one end of the load is committed. So that's what is known as a committed load. So I think I should mention it, the name of the circuit, this one. This is basically voltage to current converter using floating load. And in the inverting path, you should have a simple resistive feedback network like this. Let us call this is Vi. So this is the output terminal Vo. Let us call these resistance to be R1, this to be R2. This to be R3, and this to be R4. and there is a voltage developed across the load. Let me call this load voltage to be VL, and the current, now we are passing the current through the load because that is the purpose of placing a load in the voltage to current converter. Otherwise, keeping this one open will be good enough. For current to voltage converter, you have seen that we have just provided the output node, and that is fine. But since we are outputting a current for a voltage to current converter, so you should provide a path. So that path, through that path, the load current will be flowing. So that is the output current also. And this is I naught, this output current. Now, once again, here our objective is to find out the relation between this output current and the input voltage. So for this particular load, you have to personify this load. And what about the output resistance being seen by the load is also important here. So now we can do some source transformation at this end. So what I can do is I can start from this end. So I'm having a load like this. Now load voltage is given by VL and the load current is given by I naught. That is fine. Now what about the impression of the load? This load will see a voltage source over here with a resistance R1. Now that can be easily transformed into a current source with a resistance in series. That means by means of a Norton equivalent circuit, you can simply find out the Norton equivalent of this voltage source, because that will help us in doing the calculation. So basically, so now you have a current source instead of having a voltage source. You can have a current source with a resistance in parallel. Now you can easily understand what about the value of the current source. This is nothing but Vi upon R1, and this one is simply R1. That is fine. And for the load, the current is flowing to be, say, I naught, and this value is VL. This load voltage is VL.
That is fine.
However, we have not considered the effect of this entire thing. We have only shown this signal source VI with a series resistance R1. So that can be transformed into a current source with a parallel resistance like VI upon R1 as the amplitude of the current source and R1 to be the value of the resistance. The current source resistance coming in shunt, that is the simple Norton equivalent circuit. But so far we have not considered this one, this R3, R4, R2, and this op amp. We have not considered it so far. So if I just take a look at from this end, if I just take a look at this end, what about the impedance being seen? This impedance can be obtained if I just once again go back to this slide. If I just go back to this slide, then you'll find that this is nothing but a negative resistance converter. So the resistance being seen or being experienced at this end is given by minus this resistance multiplied with this resistance divided by this resistance. Whenever you have a connection like this, you have a negative, you have a resistive feedback network in the inverting terminal, and you have a resistance connected between the output node and the non-inverting terminal. So the effective value of the resistance was like that can be thought to be connected between this end and the ground is nothing but minus this resistance multiplied with this resistance divided by this resistance. So a similar kind of arrangement here also you can find. You have a resistive network, feedback network at the inverting terminal, and a resistance is being connected between the non-inverting node and the output node. So what about the resistance? So that resistance, so obviously there should be resistance connected between this node and this node, and this resistance you can obtain. So this resistance you can obtain by the resistance transformation theorem, and that is given by, so this is simply minus this resistance multiplied with this resistance divided by this resistance. That means this is simply minus R2 into R3 divided by R4. So minus R2 R3 upon R4. So now, if for the load, if it observes over here, so if for the load, so for the load, if the output resistance, looking through this point, if the output resistance is given by R0, then one can easily find what is the value of R0. So you have two resistance coming in shunt, so 1 upon R0 is given by 1 upon R1 plus 1 upon minus R2 R3 by R4. And however, if we just considered the load voltage and this input voltage, so now you can see this Vi upon R1 is the current. Vi of last time, what you have seen is the output current was given by Vi upon R or R1, whatever it may be. Vi upon R, that was the output current which was flowing through load. Now that is the scenario whenever we are talking about the floating load. But for a grounded load kind of thing, now Vi upon R1 is the amount of current being supplied by this current source. But now you have, apart from load, you have two other resistances as well. Like R1, you have minus R2, R3 by R4. So therefore, this time you cannot write that this output current can be written as Vi by R1. So this is not possible. Rather, what you can do is, what you can write, this time we can write is I0 can be written as some constant multiplied with Vi minus VL by RO, where RO is the effective resistance seen by the load, or effective resistance perceived by the load. So we are we have already seen that kind of arrangement. In fact, that's a kind of practical limitation, practical consideration. For ideal scenario, obviously this term will not be there. You can simply write I0 as a function of, as a linear function of the input voltage. But in order to make it possible, some condition has to be satisfied. So we are trying to find out that particular condition. So here the output current can be written as AVI minus VL by R0, because if the overall resistance over here between these two, so we have two different resistance, one is R1, second one is minus R2 R3 by R4. So if the effective resistance of this parallel combination is given by R0, and if the amount of voltage, I mean the voltage drop between these two terminals is also equal to VL, so therefore it is quite apparent that VL by R0 amount of current will be taken away by this effective resistance parallel combination R0. So instead of having these two resistance, what you can expect is we are having a single resistance R0 between these two nodes, and it is connected between two terminals for which the potential difference is equal to VL. So what about the current being drawn by this effective output resistance? So that current is nothing but VL by R0. So the total input current is Vi by R1 over here, and a portion of the current will be taken away by this effective resistance combination, and the rest of the current will be flowing as I0. So that's why I0 is written like AVI minus VL upon R naught. And that is the significance of having a negative sign over here. So you can't get the full utilization of the input voltage. Rather, a portion of the generated current is being taken away by some other part in the circuit. So now we have got, like, we have to find out what is the expression for R naught. So what you can find is 1 by R naught is equal to 1 by R1 plus 1 by minus R2 R3 by R4. So that can be written as 1 by R1 minus R4 by R2 R3. So that can be written as R2 R3 minus R1 R4 divided by R1 R2 R3. That is equal to 1 upon R0. So what we can write is R0 can be written as R1, R2, R3 divided by R2, R3 minus R1, R4. So let me just go to the next slide. What about the expression for R0? What you have got is R0 is equal to, let me just check once again. It is like R1, R2, R3 divided by. So you have R1, R2, R3 divided by R2, R3 minus R1, R4. R2, R3 minus R1, R4. So now what we can do is we can do some simplification. Keeping R2 in the numerator, if I just divide this entire thing by R1, R3, what happens? So if you divide by R1, R3, then it will be the numerator, you have R2 by R1. And here you find, if you divide it by R1, R3, so R1 gets cancelled, then R4 by R3. So that is the scenario. So R0, the output resistance as perceived by the load, is given by R2 upon this one. Now, ideally, this load must experience an infinite output resistance so that no current will be flowing through this, and the total current VI upon R1 will be flowing through this through the load, and I0 will be equal to VI upon R1, what you have seen for a floating load condition. So the ideal condition says that ideally R0 should be R0 should be infinite, so that there is no branching of current. So now to make it infinite, this numerator, whatever would be the numerator, denominator has to be zero. That means this ratio R2 upon R1 should be equal to R4 upon R3, or I mean the reverse one, R1 upon R2, or is equal to R3 by R4. Already I've seen this kind of balanced bridge condition for a difference amplifier. And here also you find that if this condition gets satisfied, then R0 will be infinite. And under this condition, what you find is this I0, this output current, can be written as 1 by R times the input voltage, that is VI. And that is possible because of the appearance of a negative resistance. You may argue that, okay, we have two resistance over here, one is R1, second one is whatever be the value. Now if one of the resistance, if both of the resistance are positive, then unless the individual values are infinite, you don't expect that their equivalent value is equal to infinite. But because of the application of this, because of the appearance of a negative resistance in the circuit, then although none of the resistance equal to zero or infinite, because both R1, R2, R3, R4, they are finite value resistance within zero to infinite. They are not zero, neither zero nor infinite, but still, because of this negative resistance conversion, the effective value or the equivalent value of the parallel combination of these two resistance can be made infinite. And for that, this condition has to be satisfied. The condition is R1 by R2 is should be equal to R3 by R4. Once again, that condition is known as a balanced bridge condition. And if this condition gets satisfied, then you can simply write I0 is equal to 1 upon R times VI. But if this condition doesn't get satisfied, then obviously there is loss of the output current as expected from this particular equation. Now, ultimately, you have to find out what about the possible excursion of the load voltage. So that we have also, that you need to calculate, which is known as the voltage compliance. So VL is the load voltage over here. So now you can understand that this VL is the voltage which is available at the non-inverting terminal. So this is the voltage over here, and this is same as this voltage. Now what about this voltage? So this voltage is nothing but, if we simply apply the current division rule, so this voltage at the negative terminal, at the inverting terminal, is given by V naught upon R3 plus R4 into R3. So that is the load voltage. So the load voltage is given by V naught into R3 by R3 plus R4. And if this condition gets satisfied, that R3 by R4 is equal to R1 by R2, then you can also write it to be V naught into R1 divided by R1 plus R2. Now from that, you can easily find out what about the voltage compliance, because this V naught can be as high as VOL, as high as VOH, and as low as VOL. So therefore, and if I assume that this VOL and VOH being the same, in that case, assuming this to be same, I mean, mod of VOL is equal to mod of VOH. So as far as the magnitude is concerned, they are same. If I assume this one, then mod of VL is limited by, it should be greater than or equal to R1 by R1 plus R2 into this VOH, and which is normally the saturation voltage, like 12 volt. For 12 volt supply, it should be 12 volt. So then the, if I consider that, okay, R1 by R1 plus R2, that ratio, so our objective here is to increase the voltage compliance. So we find that VOH, that is fixed for a particular circuit, depending upon the supply voltage provided to the op-amp circuit. Now we would like to increase that particular thing. We have to increase the voltage compliance. So therefore, if you'd like to extend the voltage compliance to some extent, then the value of R2, because in the numerator you have R1 and the denominator you have both R1 and R2. So how can you increase this one? So you have to increase this one, because this value can never be equal to VOH. It is always less than VOH. The highest possible value for the VL is always less than VOH, because the highest value is given by R1 upon R1 plus R2 into VOH. So we can say that this VL max, I think it should be better. Sorry. It is better if I write over here. So VL max, this is always less than VOH. Last time you have seen that for this floating load type of thing, the highest value of the load voltage can be as high as VOH, but this time it should be less than VOH. I mean, it cannot be even equal to VOH because of the presence of this factor R1 upon R1 plus R2. But our objective is to make this factor as close to one, as close to unity. So in order to ensure this one, you know, to extend the voltage compliance, it is desirable to keep this R2, the value of the resistance, sufficiently smaller. So to increase the compliance, I'm just writing in short. To increase the compliance, the value of R2 should be minimized, because you cannot make it zero, but if it is made small with respect to R1, then this ratio can be made very much close to unity, and then the voltage compliance of this particular circuit can be enhanced. So with this, I would like to conclude my first lecture on this op-amp circuit, and in the next class I'll be talking about some other important attributes of the op-amp circuits.